Welcome to this session, Library Love Stories. And a special welcome to all of you who are participating online. And also, of course, a welcome to you participating here in Athens. My name is Katarina Isberg. I'm from Sweden, and I'm incoming division chair and also incoming governing board member. And it's such an honor to be asked to open this session. When I am getting loose of energy, when I'm getting tired at work, I usually take a walk in the library. And I see the kids, I'm working in a public library, I see the kids who are using our services, and I see the grown-ups who are using our computers, and the persons strolling around looking for something to read. And I feel so much love. And I also feel so much energy. That really gives me a lot of energy. And love can be in many different ways. Love in libraries, that is actually something that we will see in the presentations given today, that it can take many different formats. But I think that love is key. In the world that we are living in, we have an increasing amount of fake news. We have some threats on the democratic societies as we know them. And we also have some threats of freedom of speech. And we need much more love. So I really think that the theme of this session is just right in time. It's an extremely important topic, and we all need to unite around it. I hope this will be a very lively and engaging session. And the session is a collaboration between the new professional interest group and the management and marketing sections. But of course, we need to have a keynote speaker. Is that right? Yes. So our keynote speaker is Robert Knight. Robert Knight has worked in the Australian public library sector for almost 40 years and has served in his current role as executive director of the Riverina Regional Libraries for the past 25 years. And that is a large regional library and covering an enormous geographic area. Robert loves working in the Australian library sector and has served as on numerous regional, state, and national committees and organizations. And right now, he is the president of the Australian Library and Information Association. He also was awarded an Order of Australia Medal in 2018 in recognition of his contribution to the public library sector. So please join me in giving me Robert Knight a welcoming applause.
Good morning, everybody. I'm going to bring you a little bit of information about library love stories from down under in Australia. Australian Library Lovers Day, also known as Valentine's Day, is held on the 14th of February each year. Like so many great campaigns, Library Lovers Day came about almost by accident and with a great dose of serendipity. The story goes like this. It was the summer of 2006, and my esteemed colleague and library legend Jan Richards, who a number of you may know, was co-managing the New South Wales At Your Library marketing campaign with colleague Victoria Anderson from the State Library of New South Wales. Jan had ordered 200,000 I love libraries wristbands in three colours for the holiday fun at your library summer activity. Unfortunately, to use that favourite excuse, they got held up at the docks and didn't arrive until late January, a week before school holidays ended, and obviously way too late to be used for holiday fun at your library. Jan was chatting to the then Australian Library and Information Association, ALIA, Chief Executive Sue Hutley, and lamenting the fact that she now had an office full of plastic wristbands and no idea what to do with them. Sue asked if Jan could spare 20 wristbands as she was putting together a little library lovers pack to surprise ALIA staff on Valentine's Day. Sue had read something about a Library Lovers Day in the United States and had liked the idea. She thought that Valentine's Day would be a good opportunity to boost staff morale. That turned out to be a light bulb moment. Jan quickly phoned Victoria, and within 10 minutes, Library Lovers Day was born. Jan and Victoria got to work and rolled Library Lovers Day 2006 out in just 3 weeks. The inaugural Library Lovers Day was a runaway success. The campaign had captured the imagination of all our public librarians. The logo for this first day was a red Library Lovers Day heart. And this has been a recurring image through the years, although it's no longer the official logo. In 2007, the campaign went national under the Australian Library and Information Association banner, and the runaway train known as Library Lovers Day hit the tracks. Fast forward 12 years to 2019, and Library Lovers Day has gained momentum across the country. Library Lovers Day is an opportunity for libraries and library users to celebrate all the ways that love can be found in the library. This annual event involves hundreds of libraries and thousands of library users. The event is celebrated in libraries and schools across Australia and internationally, with activities in all states and territories. In 2019, hashtag Library Lovers Day trended number 2 on Twitter, just under hashtag Valentine's Day. We intend to take Valentine's Day over at some time in the near future. Australian libraries are embracing the event with gusto, so let's have a look at some recent examples of Library Lovers Day activities. In February 2018, it was confirmed that in Australia, we love libraries. There are 1,400 public libraries across the nation, and 9.4 million people are registered library members. There are more than 113 million customer visits each year, and 37 million items are borrowed. With the inclusion of school libraries, national, state, and territory libraries, and tertiary education and special libraries, there is an estimated 13,650 libraries serving 13 million users. For Library Lovers Day 2018, we asked authors, politicians, and library users what they thought about their libraries. And their responses were collated in a booklet called Love Letters to Libraries. And I have got a few copies of Love Letters for Libraries with me, which I'll leave on the front of the stage. I haven't got many, so those of you who want who get in first will get them, and then you can auction them off. One example is a love letter from Senator Katrina Bilic, a senator for the Australian state of Tasmania, who wrote, "Library dearest, I love you. I have loved you from the day we first met, when I was in primary school, and have been visiting you regularly ever since. I've come to learn that you are not just a magic cave of books and stories. You're a hub that links different strands of my community. In fact, you don't just link, you help to create that community. I love how you welcome everybody, whether they're 6 or 60, simple or sophisticated, weak or strong, rich or poor, lonely or sociable, digital natives or complete Luddites. You give everyone a sense of belonging, and that inclusiveness warms my heart. For me, every day is Library Lovers Day. Library Dearest, you help make Australia a wonderful place to live. Keep growing and flourishing so that you continue to provide a space where we can all find ourselves and each other. The 2019 Library Lovers Day campaign was Library Love Stories. Entrants were invited to submit a 200-word flash fiction story that could be about anything, so long as it started with the writing prompt, "There was love to be found in the library." More than 600 entries were received from across Australia, and three winners were selected, who each won a $100 book voucher. This example shows the brilliance displayed by all three winners. In this case, Catherine Lamb was the author, and she said, "There is love to be found in the library. As soon as you walk through the door, you're faced with a place, a wonderful space for learning and books, fun and more. There is love to be found in the library. As you walk down through the hall, adventures everywhere while you sit on your chair and see places you'd ne'er seen before. There is love to be found in the library, with all the books lining the shelves. As you walk through the aisle, you can dream off and smile, and into a book you can delve. There is love to be found in the library, with all sorts of genres galore. You can pick, you can choose, you can ponder and muse, you can grab any book to explore. There is love to be found in all libraries, and love in the books themselves. And perhaps, if you try, one day your name might appear on a book on those shelves." Australian libraries are treated to a broad range of Library Lovers Day resources available on the ALIA website. These include posters, banners, bookmarks, postcards, shadow puppet shows, website banners, Facebook covers, and much more. So there's never any excuse for any library not to be able to really present a fantastic Library Lovers Day. In closing, I'd like to share with you how the ultimate library love story unfolded in the Max Weber Library at Blacktown in Sydney, Australia. Anthony and Cassandra met at Max Weber Library in 2007. The library became their study hub as they prepared for their higher school certificate. It also proved to be the place where friendship began and love blossomed. 8 years later, Anthony decided it was time to take the next step in their relationship at the place where their love story started. He emailed staff at Blacktown City Libraries and found the support he needed for his big romantic gesture. Anthony's and Cassandra's family and friends gathered after the library had closed and prepared the library with roses, petals, fairy lights, music, and cameras. Meanwhile, Anthony brought trusting Cassandra blindfolded to the library and instructed her, while in the lift, to remove the blindfold after he had exited on level one. He left Cassandra in the lift and sent her back to ground level. Anthony positioned himself at the top of Max Weber Library's grand staircase and waited nervously. As the lift doors opened, Cassandra took off the blindfold and was quick to notice the scattered rose petals leading her up to the library's grand staircase. After Cassandra nervously made her way up the stairs, she and Anthony embraced before Anthony got down on one knee and proposed. Upon Cassandra's response, she said yes. Family members and friends emerged from their hiding spots within the library to congratulate the happy couple. There was not a dry eye in sight, and now you can see it all for yourself. I'm pleased to report that Anthony and Cassandra have since moved to Melbourne and were married last year. They are loving married life. I hope you've enjoyed this short presentation of Library Love Stories, Australian style. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you so much, Robert, for your amazing experience. We are so glad to have received about that difficult topic, funny but serious at the same time, so many paper proposals. I just want to say that some of our speakers will speak not in English, and to say it in French. We will have a moment at the end of our session to share love stories. We received quite many love stories in the past few weeks and few days, and we selected a few one of them, and some of them will be presented, but you can also feel free to share your story if you have one in mind. There will be a moment for that. And also, these stories can be shared in any language. I mean, of course, every one of the 7 IFLA languages. But these stories can also be short. So if you want to speak in another language, it will be fine. And of course, we won't all understand everything. But we consider that it is nice to share a story in one's own language. Now, I would like to ask our first speaker to come. She's Noraini Abdurrahman. She works at the Information Management Faculty of a wonderful Malaysian university. And I have to say, we are so glad to have received so many proposals from Malaysia. As you may know, we had an incredible conference last year in Malaysia. And for us, it means a lot. It means first that Malaysia got into IFLA and got involved into IFLA more and more. It's so important to us. And also it means that today, about love, which is a very cultural issue, we won't have only a Western point of view. So we asked Noraini Abdurrahman to work on a very specific issue, the vision of love in libraries, through the lens of Malaysian film, television, and novel publishing. And Noraini, please.
Assalamualaikum everyone. How are you today? I hope you are good. Hi, good morning and Kalimera to all of you. Thank you, Anthony, for your introduction just now. Dear colleagues, thank you for coming today. And to our online viewer, thank you for watching us. So I am Noraini Abdurrahman from Kedah Public Library. Before this, I am a student in Faculty of Information Management, Kedah and UiTM Shah Alam. So first of all, I would like to thank you and PSIG and IFLA. It is a pleasure to be here today. So today, I would like to present my paper, which is entitled Libraries and Love Stories Through the Lens of Malaysian Films, Televisions and Novel Publishings. Actually, this paper is written by 3 persons, me, myself, from Public Library Kedah, from the cataloging department, and my 2 team members, which is Ms. Noraina and Muhammad Shamsul Dawood. So both of them are sending their regards to all of you because they are not been able to come here for today. So I am the presenter for today. So today we will cover about five important notes on our paper. Firstly, it should be a background, and the purpose, methodology, findings, and the conclusions. And in Bahasa Melayu or Bahasa Malaysia, we call love is cinta. We spell it like C-I-N-T-A, cinta. So love scene often used in any telefilms, films, and novels, but it is considered new to discuss love story in the library and love scenes in local publishing slants. So the fact is, love, sorry, it's been too fast. So love has its own value to complement the storyline of telefilms, films, and novel, regardless its realism for marketing strategy or to reveal the real story that happened in any setting. Love seen in local films, telefilms, and novel has proven in which real connections of library and love truly exist. So the purpose of our paper is to see an insight on how library could be directly and indirectly connected to love stories in students' campus life. And this paper is based on the perspective of local films, productions, and novel script writing. And our methodology is a qualitative, and we're using the data collection from the interview, and we do some review from the Western and Eastern movie and drama. And then the participant or the respondent for our research are film director, film producers, and the novelist itself. So based on our research, we found that there are seven key determinants findings that make all the publishing director and the novel wanted to include the libraries in their films and the novels. So we go through the one by one. So the first one will be attractions. Attraction means we have a library have attraction for all as a meeting point. So it is besides that, library is known as a knowledge center and a place for gathering. Most of the lover all out to come to the library for doing their studies, and maybe they just want to talk to each other in the library in a cool place. So based on the participant view, some of the participants says that during their studies life, the lover who always been together are labeled as couple boring, or we call it as a bored couple. Because of what? Because everywhere they go, they will go together. And collections. Do collections have influence on this? Okay. When they are taking video at the library, they must take must important thing or must the things that is very important in the library, which is the bookshelf, reference desk, book collections are obviously shown in the video to portray that the scenes happen in the library. So in Malaysia, we are focusing in this. Next, we will go to the environment. First of all, library is a silent place, isn't it? Are you agree that library is a silent place? Okay, because of a silent surrounding helps the process of audio recording become smooth and less editing, because nowadays in Malaysia we do direct recording. So they don't need to do some editing anymore if they publish if they are using library as a location for their drama or films. And then, of course, in terms of the novelist, they will need to describe the library environment in their plot clearly so that to ensure the readers have an idea or the readers can imagine what's really inside the library itself. And then we go to the facilities and the furniture. So modern furniture available at the library gave special effects to the films making and portray new library looks in the 21st century. Some of the library are equipped with all facilities that make the library become a second home for the user or the student itself. So why not? We go to the library and make some date over there. So for the marketing purpose, how it's come into place? This is a part of productions. Normally, production in Malaysia are doing the films in academic library, but focusing on the private university or the college. Due to the rules and the regulation from the National Library or the Public Library, so they prefer to use the private one. So by doing so, it will help the university or the college to have the promotion by itself. And people will browse their website when they see the films in the televisions or in other cinemas and so on. And security. Is library is one of the safest place? Do you agree? I don't hear any voice, but I see a lot of people here. Okay, library is a safer place for everyone. These lovebirds feel safe to hang out in the library or use the library as a meeting point for them. So, this is all seven elements that determine or contribute to the choice of library as a place of love story, film shooting, and plot development in the novel. Besides that, we also do some review. We are doing some review and listing from the Western and Eastern films. So we take example of the films some research regarding the Western films and Eastern films. So we found that there's a significant between the Western and the Eastern one. The first one is for the Western. Mostly the producer featured librarian as the character in their films. Compared to the Eastern, they are more featuring library and the love story. So we come to the conclusions. So as I mentioned just now, there are significant differences between Western and Eastern culture in love story films, telefilms, and novel publishing lands. And the library is a place and librarian is a profession to support love storylines in any films and telefilms. This fact is, however, will be further explored for bigger scope and context of discussion. So thank you, terima kasih. If you have any more questions or you would like to know more about our paper, you can download it through IFLA Library, or you can feel free to contact us at this email. Thank you so much. Have a good, nice day.
Thank you so much, Noraini. Now we will have the pleasure to listen to Amandine Wallon. Amandine Wallon works as head librarian at Dauphine University in Paris, and she will tell us about a very, very important matter, which is the limits when we kind of break these limits, especially among professionals, among users, but also between professionals and users. And as you could notice, We have only lightning talks because we want to keep time for the story sharing. But I invite you to read our speakers' papers on IFLA Library. They're incredibly interesting and they have done quite a great work, you know, so that we have a very serious point of view today about love and libraries. Amandine?
Thank you, Antoine. Hello, everyone. Calimera. Bonjour. I'm honored to be here today to talk with you about love. What happens when librarians and patrons cross the line? When they have sex or when they fall in love with each other? But you know, there's nothing better than listening to the actors. So prepare yourself for a little journey with some French librarians.
Oh, what can I do, my dear?
And desire on both sides of the reference desk. We've been talking to several French librarians who had a romantic or sexual relationship with users in the library.
They tell us how significant it was, what they felt, and how it affects or not their work.
Developing intimate relationships with users is a quite common phenomenon, but librarians generally prefer to ignore or avoid the question.
Interactions between librarians and patrons are generally fleeting. They take place in public. Let's see how they fall in love.
Romantic or sexual relationships between librarians and users seem inappropriate. Librarians think they do an ethical activity. What about sharing user data, for instance?
Love gives wings, but might sometimes also affect performance.
At work, you mean?
How does it look like for co-workers, for example? Let's take a ride with librarians who accepted to share their stories with us.
Et puis un jour, j'ai dit pourquoi pas. En service public, j'étais en secteur discothèque à l'époque, et donc c'est un adhérent que j'ai rencontré au cours de.
And I decided to exchange with the user about our taste in music to be able to advise the person. And this person was coming a lot of time. It was my first time that I was flirting with the user. The user was coming about photography book, and he came several times. I met a person in my working place, and I've met a lady. She was crying, and as a professional, I went to see if she was okay. And we are hosting people, we are helping them, and sometimes they are asking some stuff that are very general, broad, and sometimes it's very personal. It was just touches and little words we cannot say to everyone. Yeah, I think when it's in libraries, it had something, because in libraries we are very close to the user.
We do a really great job that gives love a chance to blossom.
What about material desired relationships?
That's a thing that all should enjoy, even if we must keep in mind that there are job-related consequences.
We don't manage love, do we?
J'ai eu des petites.
I had some comments from my colleagues, and they said, "Oh, you admire." One of my colleagues was. I talked to my colleague because I thought it was important to talk about it. I didn't want people to know about it in my team. I always try to separate the two worlds. I clarified stuff with colleagues. With some other, I said that nothing was going to happen. I think I was doing some specific job at my desk, but I wanted to go out and go to the reading place, even though it wasn't my time. When I'm in public service, I'm not supposed to talk to someone, just only one. When I went to the public service and I met someone, I didn't thought it was not proper. If I had to do it again, yeah, of course I'll do it again, because there were no bad consequences. Yes, of course, because I had to try something very fast and talking to someone. Yeah, of course I'll do it again.
Or long-term love. Couples fall in love in libraries. What do you think, managers? Is dating users a good or a bad idea? Do take a look at our website. There's lots of information there about this series. The people who put our program together include Sylvain Aucordier, Aurélien Thom.
Well, from Paris, it's Double LS program. I'm Gaët Angot.
I'm Amandine Wallon. Back next week with more library love stories. Goodbye.
Thank you. Just one word. I would like to thank Gaët Angot, the second radio speaker who was not able to attend the Congress. He's a librarian in Paris. He works at the National Museum of Natural History. I would also like to thank all the librarians who helped us, especially the interviewees, because it's not easy to talk about love. And last but not least, I would like to thank all the volunteers here in Greece who were so helpful and patient with me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Amandine. I forgot to introduce myself. I'm Antoine Terence. I'm from France, and I'm the outgoing convener of the New Professional Special Interest Group. Now, we had two continents. Let's have a look at the third one. We will have now, you'll see, I think you'll like it. It's a paper that comes from Africa, and that comes from the French Institute of Dakar. So our colleague Mandiaye Yetiaye will present it. Mandiaye works at the University Cheikh Diop in Dakar, and the study has been conducted by Ajavi Fume and Fatima Orisogay from the French Institute of Dakar. Mandiaye.
Good morning, sabah al khair, bonjour, nangendef. Donc c'est un salut en fait venant du Sénégal de deux charmantes dames qui avec l'ensemble des collègues qui nous suivent.
Who just say hello to you, and they have undertaken this inquiry, this survey. And it was a survey in order to present the result of the study. We had decided to a case study in the various libraries, so to find the feelings in library. We know that the evolution of the role of libraries and what librarians are doing currently in the world, then they become quite often there are kind of relationships that be developed who become loving relationships, and the outcome, and also that in the two cases they can have some consequences of these becoming closer together. Here, this is the kind of study that this survey was sent to different colleagues, former colleagues, and also to users of libraries, and the western part of Francophone Africa, and we did three case studies: the love between librarian and users, and love between librarians themselves and colleagues. And also the third point between between users. And we notice quite often that these feelings are reciprocal. Then they lead to happy events, such lasting relationships as couples. And if it is not shared, then this feeling, they can go to sexual difficulties, then whatever it is, you have to judge to manage the situation. So the study that we undertook in order to this survey shows that 17% they've fell in love of other users, library users in the library. So as you can see, the percentage, 33% have declared or stated, 33% of the users fell in love with a librarian, and the librarians are easier to state their feeling than the librarians themselves. Then 17%, in the case of after they received this statement of love, and they so once when they respond favorably to this. They're very often, many times, the person that is not in agreement, there's the survey, who have what they have to take care of the situation, because in reality, some would say each time that they try to put back books on their shelves, or that person tries always to try to touch them on the shoulder, tap them on the shoulder. So this is, which is a form of some kind of a harassment, in a sense. So this leads to, it's a question of ethics and professional conduct. So try to explain in the statement, the feeling is not shared, then they want to show them that the relationship that they have developed with them, it's just more, is a need for information than anything else. Those who replied to the survey, they explained that I told them to my colleague my expression of love, but this is reciprocal, so that it was okay, it was easier. Then the couple who's going fine and they got married, one of those who was surveyed, who was cited, He said, explain also that he refused this. He tried to explain why he had to reject, that the attention that was directed towards him was more to answer in a professional fashion and to a need of information than anything else. Then another case of the last one, that those who didn't share the feeling, they say, when I put books away and he passes by next to me, he always taps me in my shoulder or just look at me in a lascivious fashion. I always like so I like to often try to avoid that person. Then I see this as a dilemma, it's a difficulty. That's what is real, is that there are many different countries, because in the code of deontology, the librarian is a taboo. Librarians not very prepared to deal with that type of situations. That 69.4% of those who were surveyed had not received any kind of training to deal with those issues, and developed the kind of reflexes and how to deal with those issues. They don't have the competencies to deal with those issues. This type of they feel quite often they need to be informed on the subject. They have a framework of discussion to be able to deal with this type of activity. Here, that's what we found. Our two colleagues have presented. Here, the document is already in the library of the IFLA library. So if you have more questions, they'd be glad to answer your question, and either online or otherwise. So here's the way to communicate with them. Thank you very much.
What is love? You know, even between two people who are in love, it's not always easy to define what it is. And that's why we will now listen to Parisa Passiar, who will present a study by Asmet Momeni and Farhas Danesho. They all work at the Department of Knowledge and Information Science at Alameh Tabatabai University in Tehran, Iran. Parisa.
Thank you, Anthony. Hello, everybody. Salam from Iran. I'm Parisa Passiar from National Library and Archives of Iran, and I'm here for present my friends because they couldn't have the chance to come here and see you here. My friend's name is Matt Momeni and Farnaz Danesho. They are from Alameh University, and their work is about the perception, teenagers' perception of love during a classic story, Iranian story, named Layli and Majnun. I don't know how many of you know about it, but I have a presentation of that story in a summary. Layli and Majnun is a narrative poem composed by one of the poets of Iran, Nezami Ganjavi. But it's basically is an Arab story. And you know, Nezami is a Persian. The young lovers, Layli and Majnun, fall in love in the school. They meet and know each other there. what happened. Sorry. Majnun began to say poems for Layli because he wants to attract her. And he mentions her name for many, many times. She repeated as all the people call her Majnun because the Majnun's means is being mad. At last, he asks Layli's father to be married with Layli, but her father didn't agree, and Layli goes to get married with another man and moves from that place. Majnun goes to the desert, and he surrounds and wanders everywhere, and he wrote her his poems in the sand and asked the wind to send her message to the Layli. On the other hand, Layli is really sad and have a deep sorrow, and she doesn't let to her husband to come close, and at last he died because of this sorrow. When Majnun hears about this news, go and come Layli's grave and wrote his poems on that grave and died there. This is a really tragedy, but it's a spiritual journey in this Majnun's behavior and all what he do. My friends try to find the whole theme of the story, and the main idea of this story is the intimacy, passion, and commitment. On the other hand, some special subjects like sincerity, consciousness, self-sacrifice, and evolution from earthly love to the heavenly love. Then they tried to ask the teenagers that what is their perception of love, if they have any idea about those terms. At the beginning, teenagers thought that they have. I do confuse with this. They have a very good knowledge about love, but when they go to the details, for example, about self-sacrifice or about evolution from earthly love to the heavenly love, it seems that they have somehow ideas about it, and it's not really clarified for them. My friends begin to tell the story and show the images that I showed you and try to talk about this classic story that they didn't have heard before. After that, the perception of love become in the high level, but it was not so different between them. Because it was a short time, and it seems that having a perception about love needs a real journey and needs having somehow a behavior like Majnun to have some conception about it. Thank you so much for paying attention.
Thank you so much, Parisa. Our last speaker, Demet Soylu from Turkey, couldn't make it to the conference today, unfortunately. So we won't have the pleasure to hear her, but you will be able to read her paper online, of course, in the IFLA library in the next few days. Now I think we'll switch to the questions moment. So don't hesitate to ask questions. You have many ways for that. You can use Mentimeter. You can use the Congress app. Have you seen the question and answers function in the Congress app? It's on the first page when you just scroll on the right in the menu. You have the Q&A function, so you can type your question. And you can also, of course, just ask your questions by asking one of our volunteers for the microphone. Thank you.
So my name is Andrew Finnegan. I'm from Australia, and I'll be leading a discussion with our panelists who have presented some very wonderful presentations. So I wanted to start by talking about the idea of the library as a space. What is it about library spaces that can evoke these kind of themes of emotions and love and passion? Would anyone like to start?
Merci. Bon, nous considérons en fait que la bibliothèque est un espace de vie, donc un espace de rencontre. Donc naturellement, là où les humains se rencontrent avec tout ce qu'il y a comme diversité, donc qui se rencontrent, donc l'énergie qui circule fait que en fait ça débouche naturellement sur une vie sentimentale.
The sentimental life and interaction.
If I may add something, there are multiple opportunities of contact in a library. For example, during training sessions, workshops, at the reference desk. You know, personal interactions between librarians and patrons, because I've studied that, it involves cognitive, affective, and relational matters.
Thanks. In terms of the design, maybe Robert, you can comment the way that we design libraries. To what extent do we put that emotional connection into, say, the colours or the shapes of the space?
Andrew, I think the design of libraries is particularly important in relation to not only their functionality, but also for their desirability as public spaces. And so there is a lot more in the 40 years that I have been in public libraries, particularly a much more of a focus now on how the library looks and feels, as well as its functionality. And I think people respond to that because we see such massive amounts of people using our libraries, not only in Australia, but worldwide.
And Noroni, I read your paper. You had quite a bit to say about the idea of a library as being a place of positive values. Could you please talk a little bit more about that, just in terms of being a space where people can come and feel good about the space and feel like it's a space where they can connect with other people with similar values?
Okay, thank you, Andrew. Actually, library as a value means that we can use a library as a platform to meet other peoples and share our knowledge and sharing our ideas through the walls. So maybe we can conduct some knowledge sharing sessions to share our experience to others, so they can we can inspire others to doing well in their works.
Okay. the other thing that we you also mentioned, and maybe the others can comment on, is the idea of a library as a safe and secure space. Obviously, when it comes to emotions, we need to be very mindful that we can feel safe and comfortable. So how can we do that in the way that we create those spaces?
About the security of the library, I thought that you are asking our friend. May I ask you to repeat your question?
When we are creating library spaces as spaces that you know we want to use to inspire people, a theme that came up before was the idea of safety and security. Now, when we're talking about love, that's a very big part of that. And how can we help make people comfortable and safe?
You know, when we talk about the space in the architecture, maybe the best thing and the ideal thing is to think about make the space to a place. That is what makes a house home. I think we should do the same in the library, and we should design somehow that people think that it's there is their home and feel safe in their places.
Okay, so we're talking about creating a familiar space,
yeah,
a space that's perhaps will create a sense of intimacy, whether it's solitary intimacy or working together with a couple of other people, and maybe through that kind of connection, other feelings may come along.
Yeah, this is the same, I think, about the home. Of course, there are some differences, but you know, we need in the home some private places for ourselves. In the library, sometimes we need to be concentrated, and sometimes we need to have connection with others. For example, the same when we are in a lunch together at home. I think we can have some compare between these things, but of course there are different places and different contexts. Yeah.
Of course, I think a big thing in library design is to have that agility so people can choose how they want to use that space, whether they want to use it to interact or whether they want to be alone and focused.
Yeah.
If I may, in the stories we have collected, we have two about this issue about space. The first one is an episode of the TV show Friends, where Ross Geller, I think, discovers that people are using a very specific place of the library to meet, and sometimes more, and it's exactly the place where his PhD, his published PhD is, and people choose that place because no one goes there. So he gets really offended, but it's quite interesting to think, okay, do our libraries have, you know, places, discrete places? And I've heard also in another story that from someone here at IFLA, that some people were creating the library and building the library in order to avoid these blind spaces, because of course we should, like librarians should control the space at some point and should have a look at people just in case they steal anything or something. And there's quite a contradiction between that idea of a controlled space and a space of freedom and maybe free for encounters.
Yeah, I think that traditionally a lot of library designs have had that panopticon kind of design where the librarian is at the reference desk and they can see what every single person is doing in the space. So I think it's important to also trust people so that they can feel comfortable doing what they like.
Andrew, in relation to the safe spaces of libraries, I think that in Australia, and I expect elsewhere as well, libraries are becoming and promoting themselves as safe spaces and welcoming spaces. And interestingly, as buildings change in our cities and there is less living space in a lot of houses for people, they are indeed becoming the alternative living space for people who perhaps haven't got room to study at home or to get some quiet space at home. So I think that dynamic's changing quite a lot. And in relation to intimate spaces in libraries, I doubt that any are actually built specifically with an intimate space in mind, but unfortunately people do find them.
Yeah. So moving on, I just wanted to look at the idea of the librarian as a professional and what these ideas of librarian, what these ideas of librarians and love, what implications they have for us as professionals. I think in pop culture we've seen many librarians from, you know, Marion the Librarian we heard before, and if for those who know, It's a Wonderful Life, you've got the wife who now that her husband never existed anymore, her fate was to be closing up the library on Christmas Eve. It was a fate worse than death. more recently, we see librarians who are very very passionate, very strong kind of characters, very knowledgeable, and in some ways, they kind of become an object of desire in both traditions. And of course, that becomes problematic or desirable or makes some people feel uncomfortable, makes some people feel confident. How do these themes affect us all as librarians as we interact with people? We talked a bit about relationships between librarians and users, being approached by our users. Of course, we need to form strong relationships of trust, but at the same time, we need to be mindful. So how can we manage those relationships and our own image and the way that people see us?
That's a good question. In fact, librarians tend to feel a little bit uncomfortable when saying that they have or had an intimate relationship with a patron, and I see two reasons for this. First of all, it has to do with desire and physical attraction, because it's not easy, you know, to share about it. It's something so personal. And the second reason is that there are normative expectations at workplace. Sex and love might conflict with the requirements of the job. So it is important to acknowledge that some encounters at the library may have relational consequences. But yes, it's a big issue. In most cases, everything is going well. There are potential romantic partners who are creating connection, and that's it. And the relationship keeps going on outside the library.
Let me add something else. That's quite a complex question, because there is a balance to have the professional, the deontology, and the human sentiment. The library, there's a space as the librarians, they are there to make people at ease. So by one of the recommendation of this survey that we do, that the librarians must not feel like this statement of love should not be offensive, should be either accepted or deny or decline, but you have to have in a professional fashion. It's quite complex in the professional deontology.
Well, it's really complicated, and I don't have any idea about it. You know, I was working for a lot of time in the for about 9 years in the digital library, and I didn't have interaction with users in the physical. I just read the comments and answered them. There was not. I don't have experience about it to talk about. But many of my colleagues in the reference desk has lots of stories about the love. For example, one of them that he's married, once said that one of the users came to him and asked lots of questions about the psychology, and the conversation went to the what is the your type of the character and other things. And he said that in a moment I realized what is going to happen. And then I began to talk about my wife, and in a minute or in a second, the girl said that, okay, I have a work and I should to go. Bye, see you later. Oh. Yeah.
Yeah, we're librarians, not relationship counselors, right? Sometimes, well, we, anyway. On a related note, we talked a bit about harassment in the workplace. Those of us who've worked in libraries will know that it does happen, and it can be quite difficult to deal with. So what mechanisms or what policies do you have in your libraries to support your librarians and your users who do experience harassment in the library?
Well, in Iran, there are really strict policies because it's somehow forbidden to have a relationship in, for example, for love in the workplace. They prefer it doesn't happen, and they don't say anything if it happens and it go to something, but there are some cultural mind, it's cultural things in the mind of the librarians to not to be engaged with users. There are some line between them for these relationships.
Yeah. I think as a manager, well, it could be both ways. It could be that the staff is harassing each other, of course, but it could also be that the staff is harassed by a customer. So as a manager, I think it's really important to always stand beside your staff and be sure that if they experience that they are feeling harassed or in any way, you should always take that serious. Because you shouldn't let them or force them to take that conflict alone. You have to make sure that there is people supporting them.
Thank you, Anya. We'll have a moment for questions shortly. But I'll look at some of the questions. There's one question that we received through Menti, which is related to this topic. The question is, do you think there has been an evolution in the past decades? As in terms of harassment, is there less harassment than there used to be, or more?
Evolution of the.
Is it getting better, or is it getting worse?
Excuse me, my English is not so good. When you talk fast, I lost the words. So sorry.
I apologize. When it comes to harassment, mm-hmm. are things getting better or worse for library staff?
When to get what? What is it? I don't know the meaning of the word.
Of which word? Harassment. So when people are approaching you in an inappropriate way in the workplace with feelings of what they might think of as love?
You mean the love between the colleagues? Do you?
It can be either a colleague or...
Excuse me, I can't understand your word. So sorry for not answering it. Maybe I should check it in the Google Translate.
Would anyone else like to comment on that?
Okay, in terms of the harassment at work, okay, it might be something that we should take an action, because if our staff is having harassment by the user or someone else, so it will be a problem to the staff itself, so you must take a concern on that. Yeah.
And do you think it's getting better?
Getting better in terms of what? The harassment or that person
the way
himself?
Our experiences as libraries.
Yeah.
Do you think things are getting better for us?
For me, it's not good because if my give impact on the staff itself. So maybe when the harassment happened, the staff will feel down. So she don't want to work, or she will be demotivated. So we should do something to curb that one.
Thank you.
I think that generally speaking, there's a much broader awareness of harassment, both between colleagues and between workers and their the people who use the library. So there's also, I think, a better training framework now for people, and much broader policy framework, pretty much in most businesses. I think, though, that libraries are suffering a different form of harassment, other than sexual harassment, with a marked increase in homeless people who are using libraries, and perhaps through mental illness and what have you, where librarians are, of course, frontline service providers who welcome everybody, and so it becomes more important for libraries to ensure that they have policies, training and procedures in place for their staff to be able to deal with these matters considerately, but also promptly.
Okay, I think it's a good moment. We had a few hands up, people with questions. So if they have a question, we've got a microphone going around. But in the meantime, I'll go with one of our other questions on Menti while we get ready. Do you think people agree about what love is? For example, in countries where marriage situations, there's a difference in the cultures, like arranged marriages and so forth.
Do you want to ask the last question again about the harassment? I found the word.
Yes. So the question is, do you think people agree on what love is? Especially when you consider we come from different countries,
uh-huh.
and there are different cultural approaches to love and marriage.
Yeah, I think love has different language. All the people see it in their hearts. It's not about the language, about the... You see it in the eyes, I think.
Yeah.
So romantic.
It's very true.
I think the language of love is universal, and the difference it's in the way they express it. Even if we are not of the same country or background, it's just the way we express that is different, but it's a universal language that is understandable, and love is understood by everyone, no matter the language used.
Please. Yeah, thank you. Okay, we all know that librarians are very friendly people because dealing in a daily basis with different ideas, with different thoughts. My question is, how do you deal with toxic colleagues that happen?
Sorry, how do you deal with what colleagues?
Toxic colleagues.
Oh, toxic
yeah,
colleagues.
We have some colleagues who are really toxic. They behave badly, and sometimes some of them do not love mankind.
It's a very big issue across the whole world, I would say. But would anyone like to tackle that one?
Well, I would say that sometimes it's a problem that librarians love books more than they love people, of course. But this is a profession, so it should be, by the managing staff, it should be made clear that this is not about what you love. It's how you are supposed to interact with the customers, right? And you should provide the service, even if you don't love them, so.
Okay. Do we have any more questions on the floor at the moment? Whilst I move on to another one of our questions. What is the influence of the portrayal of libraries and librarians in popular culture on the way users approach librarians? So we touched upon that before, but does anyone want to talk about how you know people have approached you based on their stereotypes that they've seen maybe in TV or in a movie?
I don't have any answer for it.
It's okay. Does anyone else have a comment?
Yes, just a comment. From my study, I've noticed that there is an heteronormative view of librarianship. And there is this stereotype of the female librarian who is supposed to love sex and... it enters in contradiction with this other stereotype that female librarians are sexually repressed or spinsters. So there are different images and they conflict one with each other.
It's very true. We get all types. Mm-hmm. Yes. We have another question. Does the panel believe that the idea of the library as a safe and secure space might have special significance for LGBTQ people, so people from the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer communities?
Well, I think so, yes, because if you're in the LGBTQ community or any other, what would you say, marginalized group, it is very important the way you get treated when you come to the library. So it's not just about being welcoming, it's also about not assuming things, not assuming that everyone has a partner of the opposite sex, not assuming that everyone is in a marriage with two people. So yes, I think it's important that we are open, welcoming and not just assuming.
Yeah, I think that inclusiveness is really an important aspect of libraries, and on that very topic of the LGBTIQ population, one of the entrants in one of the New South Wales Public Libraries Association scholarships last year was the winning one was actually to research that very subject and the way that libraries are dealing with the LGBTIQ community and ensuring that the space is both, you know, both inclusive, welcoming, and relevant to that sector of our community.
Now, another question: do you think that love, especially relationships that we've been talking about, is a taboo topic amongst librarians? Is it a taboo? Do we think that there is a feeling that we cannot talk openly about these things from your experience?
Bon, comme les collègues qui ont...
Like what the colleagues have shown, it depends on the context, social and cultural. In Africa, it's a question that is not always discussed. If we talk about the reality of the professional space, it's not a question that is expressed openly, even more in a professional area. Librarians need to talk about it in professional circle, in our association of a librarian. During the Valentine's Day, a Senegalese librarian have organized a workshop around love to start the discussion on those topics. I think we should develop those sessions like that. People would have more tools.
I agree, because we've seen in the study that establishing or pursuing personal relationships with patrons is quite a common phenomenon. But librarians generally prefer to ignore or avoid thinking of it. So I think we don't have to be naive, and we have to talk about it more, yes, like today, for example.
Absolutely agree. Do we have any more questions from the floor? Because I'm about to wrap up the discussion and we'll move on to our next part. But I have one last question for you all. As librarians and people who work in libraries, stories play a big role in the way that our society and cultures develop. And so how can libraries help make those connections between stories and our users? And are love stories that important? Because there are some who would say that love and romance is not a serious topic and it sometimes gets put into the paperback corner. So what is the importance of stories and love stories in your library, and what makes a good love story?
I think that it reminds us of the challenges of libraries nowadays. Libraries are having a purpose. They have a purpose for users, and all the question users have should be addressed. And the fact that we can collect love stories shows the relevance of libraries in the way we are addressing users' problems. And we are offering a services that is linked to users' needs, and we should share those stories.
I think that there is a certain romanticism associated with libraries, and we see that in popular culture a lot. So often when you read a book or watch a movie, or even in Australia there was a television series called The Librarians, I think that people do have a romantic association with libraries, and that's certainly been demonstrated quite comprehensively in Australia through the Library Lovers Day, where people, where 600 people wrote a library love story. So, yeah, definitely, I think that that there is a link there.
Parisa, I might ask you a quick question. With the story of Lelian and Majnun, with the story, what is it about this really traditional story? It's a very old story, but your teenagers and the youth really connect with that. Is it the love? Is it the tradition? Is it everything about it?
Both of them. You know, the tradition is one of the most important thing because, you know, it's somehow in the blood of the people. When they see it everywhere, they hear about it from their grandmoms somehow. It's we have a traditional night named Yalda, the first night of the winter. Most of the time, grandmoms say stories, and one of those stories is these traditional stories about love. They have, you know, sometimes it seems that it's a sad story, and what we don't need it when we want to talk about the love. We want sometimes happy thing of love. But in our culture, being just in love with a man or with a human being is not enough. They need something more. They like to make it higher and go to the, for example, God. It's a traditional culture in our society. And I think the elements in these stories that don't let the people join together and they think that they will find each other in another way, and in for example they die and they join together in another life is somehow is related to this culture.
Thank you. So that's all the time we have for questions. We're going to move on to a very exciting part of the session, which Antoine and Anya will introduce.
Yes, hi, good morning. I am Anya Feldröter, I'm from Sweden. I'm the incoming chair of the management and marketing section. First of all, I just want to thank all of our speakers for these great presentations. And I also want to thank you all for participating in the panel. We had a lot of questions that we didn't had the time to answer, but just make sure that you catch one of the speakers and ask them afterwards. So this was a lively discussion, and I'm happy for that. But now it's time to make the room even more vibrant as we move into the part where you all can contribute. We have some people with us that has who want to share their library love stories. And after that, anyone of you in the public, in the audience, who want to participate is welcome to do so. Don't be shy. You can share your library love story in any language you want. It's not just the IFLA languages, it's in any language. But please remember to keep it short, about 2 minutes. And may I ask you, no gossip, because we don't want stories about people who don't want their stories to be shared, of course. Okay, so please join me here on the stage. You who has signed up for sharing your story, please come forward, and then we'll make a Swedish line, I guess, and everyone is supposed to be, who wants to come here, can be here. Mic is yours.
Hello to everyone. My name is Ayla.
And I'm Adnan Churuat.
We are a married couple from Bosnia and Herzegovina. We both work in Gazi Husrev Bey Library, and that is the main reason why we are here today on this stage with you. So after my master's degree in library and information sciences, I started working as an intern in Gazi Husrev Bey Library in 2015. And that was like my dreams are coming true, because I always dreamed that I would work in such a wonderful, great, and fantastic library.
I had already booked a paid trip for some winter holidays in January 2017, but just one day before my trip, I got a call for a job opportunity at Gazi Husrev Bey Library. So I was in some kind of a dilemma. Should I go on a fully paid trip with my best friends, or on the other hand, it was just an interview, like many others I had. But something inside me was telling me that I should go to this job interview, and so I decided to follow my inner voice, and I quit my trip, and I went to this interview, and now I know it was the right decision, and I did the right thing, because I got the job. So on my first day of my new job on 1st of February in 2017, I met this beautiful creature standing right next to me, and it was the love on the first sight for the both of us.
So 1 month later, we were dating, and 7 months later, we got married. So now we are first timers on IFLA together.
Thank you. The product of our librarian love is now growing inside of my wife's belly, and in 2 months we are expecting a baby, and we can't be any happier than this.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for listening to our love story. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Magda. I'm from Poland. I would like to tell you my colleague's library love story. So let me start from the beginning. On the one day, spring, lovely day, the director and professor at the university in Poland, he thought that he could take his student to a building site because they were on the last year of the library science and they should have known everything about library, especially how to build the one. So my colleague was in this group and when they came to the library, I mean in the empty library because they were only windows, walls, and is it. And the person who welcomed them was a very handsome and charming man with blonde hair and green eyes. And he was one of the team of building managers. He wore the white helmet and he told them everything about walls, about windows, about doors and shown how well reading rooms would be, also cataloging department and director's office. And my colleague, she doesn't remember all details, but she she remember this feeling when she met him and this thought that he would be her husband. And now they are together for 20 years. They have two daughters. And she works in this library. Yeah, thank you.
Hi, I'm David, a librarian from Colombia. And I want to share a story about love, but maybe it's a little bit different. Because this is a love story between librarians and other disciplines. In Colombia, with a group called Bibliotecarios al Senado, it's something like librarians to the Congress. We believe that we are important as a profession, but we were fighting with other institutions, let's say, or other organizations, and let's say, we say it, for example, as librarians, but you are, you know, this big capitalist, you just care about money, and they say, you librarians are hippies, you librarians are pirates, you know? And in Bibliotecarios al Senado, we believe that all the librarians are rock stars. It's better explaining it like this.
Hello. I just want you to join me to this. We librarians are rock stars. Now you, I want to hear you. We librarians. I know that you need lunch at this time, but once again, the last one. We librarians are rock stars. Yeah, thank you very much. So what we made is that we promote something called querendura. It's a strange Spanish word. It's like say love, I don't know. But it means that in the libraries we love a lot, and we share a lot, and we are all in the same side. We love all the organizations, and we change the copyright law because we are love each other as librarians. Thank you very much.
Hello, hello. My name is Milica, I'm from Serbia, and I have a story about one poems. Because when I wrote an article for our library journal, about the role of a librarian in the public literature, I find these poems dedicated to one of our colleagues. It's a very romantic love story, in which you see that our famous poems, our famous writers falling in love with one some colleagues. I can translate a nickname, but it's mean woman with very blue eyes and very blue hair. And these poems still, I forgot the name of poems, but the name of writers is Miroslav Maksimović, but the name of our colleagues is a secret for you, but not a secret for me, but I'm a librarian, and this secret stay with me. Bye, this is it.
Hello, my name is Hendrik, I'm from Germany, and I would like to share a story of my library. We have these two patrons. They were a couple, and they were also very good friends with my boss. So this one time, the guy in the relationship, he said to his girlfriend, "Honey, we have to go to the library." And she said, "But they're closed today. It's like Friday afternoon, so they are closed." "Yeah, but we have to go there because the boss, our good friend, she still has something we left at the party. So we will get it back when we go to the library." So that was the setup for his surprise. And when they got there, she knew something was off because there was like rose petals on the floor. There were candles lit. And so that was different from usually. So they followed the path of the rose petals. And there was a choir, and this choir sang her a song of her favorite band. It was a love song, and at the end of the song, the guy got down to one knee and proposed. So she said yes, and now they are married for 2 or 3 years, and they have a child, and they visit our library very frequently, and so it's nice to see the child grow up, you know. So there's a great connection, and I think that's a great thing to be part of something like this. Thank you.
We also received a few stories from people who couldn't attend today's session. And one of them is quite similar to the one we heard before. It's the story of a group of girls in a university library. And you know how girls are. Like, you know, they talk together, they gossip. Boys are the same. But there was that very elegant student in the library, and they were like all looking at him, and it was kind of a competition. And it took a few months, but finally they talked to him and they became friends, like as a group. But one of them won the game. Finally, after 1 year, he asked her out. And after one more year, he proposed. now they have 4 children. And I don't know how they did because they are my age, so apparently they did it very quickly. And that person just told me that last week, it was the holidays in Paris, and they took their children to visit the libraries where they fell in love. And of course, the baby couldn't really understand, but the first child is 4 or 5 now, so he really understood what it was and found it quite beautiful that his parents met in a beautiful library. Are there any other stories? Yeah, please.
Well, I have the second story. It's about one of our pioneer librarians in Iran who was the supervision of many basic projects in Iran, like subject headings and many processing, book processing projects. Her name was Puri Soltani, and I have her badge here. She was a great lady when he was young, about, for example, 65 years ago. She married with an author and who was a journalist, and he was a very famous one. They lived together for about 6 months. Because of the politic things, the man went to the prison, and after a little time, they hanged him up. And about 60 years, this lady lived with that love, because the thought of that man was very high, and many letters of him was leading her to do very great things. Puri Soltani had done a translation of a book, The Art of Loving, by Eric Fromm. And I think the things that he translated was went inside of her, because all the colleagues of her has has a great deal with her, and say they really say that they loved her, and because of this love, they did what she asked them to do. And because of this integrity, many big projects has done without little budgets, and many big works, for example, the integration of the Tehran Book Processing and National Library of Iran, that made a very good foundation for doing many things, many new things, was because of this heart relationship between that team. Thank you.
Any story from the floor? Else we have like hundreds. Okay, so just, oh. Please come. Please come. Anyway, we will also publish some of the stories, of course only those when the authors authorized us to do so. We'll publish them on our blog, npsig.wordpress.com, in the next few days.
Please. Esta es una historia de amor de los intérpretes.
This is a love story between one of the interpreters, Patri. Right now she's not in the room, and another interpreter, Nicholas, they fell in love and they got married, they got a baby. His name is Jaime and he's here in IFLA this year for the first time. She didn't want to come here because she's shy. And she said that her husband is going to be very, very angry, but I think that it was a worthy story.
Hello, my story too is about library and language and users, because I work in a very international, multilingual, multicultural environment and library, and I fall in love with a colleague, she was Polish, and I've decided to, as a first thing, to learn Polish, and I enrolled in a Polish language course. But she was not too much interested to me. It's quite hard to spend months with a colleague you are in love with and you have, and she is not so much interested. But then I fall in love with a user this time. She was Greek from Athens, like the half of the Greek population, and in that case as well, I decided to enroll in a Greek language course. Τώρα μιλάω ελληνικά τέλεια. Ήμασταν παντρεμένοι και έχουμε δύο παιδιά. Ευχαριστώ, Αθήνα.
I think our time here is over, so I just have to thank you, to thank our wonderful speakers for their speeches and their papers, to thank, of course, our friends from NPSIG group and from management and marketing session. I would like also to thank our friends Hassan Fall and Maria Simonovic, who took a big part in our activities but couldn't afford to come to the conference this year. And of course, I would like to thank IFLA staff who did a great job. You know, it's live streamed and it's quite a complicated technical issue. And of course, I would thank you all for coming and for sharing our stories either online or on leaflets or today during this session. And I wish you a very beautiful end of the conference. Thank you all. Thank you.